So you can start screen sharing.
Okay. Just a second. So can you see that?
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the photography workshop. We have Mr. Mayuresh Hendre with us. Mr. Mayuresh has been into photography for a very long time now. Some of his pictures have broken the internet, one of which was the golden tiger shot at the Kaziranga National Park in Assam. We're looking forward to have a great time with you. Over to you, Mr. Mayuresh.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity, SSL team. So I would like to just apologize because on 19th, this was supposed to happen, but it could not happen due to some technical problems. But anyways, I'm just going to talk about the photography work that I have been doing, and I'm just going to give you some basic idea and tips about photography, and I'm going to begin. And one more thing I would like to start with is that I'm very proud right now because I'm getting an opportunity to present my work in front of Xavier Rights, because I have been part of the institution and I have graduated from there, and it really feels good that I can give back something to the institution, and whatever the institution has done for me, I can give it back in some or the other way. So you look at the screen, you see a bird there, and that bird is the oriental dwarf kingfisher. And this photograph, this particular photograph, is very close to my heart because this picture has been taken in 2015. I think I was 2 years into photography by then. And this bird, because of the colors, it is very close to my heart. And also because it is taken here in Mumbai, in the Sanjay Gandhi National Park. So this particular bird is the oriental dwarf kingfisher, which comes here during the monsoon. And I have captured that in the backyard, in our backyard, that is Sanjay Gandhi National Park. So this is what wildlife photography is to me, to find nature in our backyard, even in an urban city, like one of the most populated cities in the world, Mumbai. You have some part of nature there, and you can go to that nature and you feel happy about it. So that is the oriental dwarf kingfisher for you. So now I'm going to share my journey with you about how I became a wildlife photographer and why I became a wildlife photographer. So I was always attracted to nature. As a child, I used to go to my ancestral home and I used to climb on the roof of the house there, and I used to observe birds, butterflies there. And later, my dad got me a digicam. And using that digicam, I went around the city and I started taking pictures of butterflies. That was the first bit of nature I could see. And I was quite attracted to butterflies. So I was going and clicking around everywhere. Later, I joined St. Xavier's College and I selected mass media as a course. And as I selected mass media, I was attracted to, and I was exposed to, a lot more things that media can do, like photography, video, everything. And that's where my journey began. And I also, through the internet, saw one video which I would like to show you now. I'm just going to stop the share here and I'm going to show you that video. That video is of a wildlife photographer whom I follow, who is my inspiration. He is an Indian. His name is Sandesh Kadur, and he is a National Geographic explorer and a wildlife photographer, who also a filmmaker who has been making films and documenting the wildlife of India since a lot of time. So that video is his showreel, but that video is what inspired me to get into this field. So I'm going to show that video too. It is video to you. So it is a short video of 3 minutes. Just a second. Just tell me, Shubham, if you can see my screen.
Yes, sir. So I think you should put it on the presentation mode.
Yes, just wait a second. I'm just going to share that. All right, you can see, right? A black screen with a logo.
It is loading.
All right.
No, it's not coming up, sir.
Okay. Let me. I have shared the screen. Should I play it?
Oh, yeah, it's coming now.
Okay.
Yeah, it's up. You can start playing.
Okay. So I'm going to play it now. I've started playing. So I hope you could see that video. So that was a video or a showreel of a wildlife photographer and filmmaker. And that wildlife photographer was Mr. Sandesh Kadur. And he has been my inspiration to come in this field and to just admire nature and love nature and to do what I am doing today. So that's how my journey began after seeing that video. And also then we had a workshop in MMR, in St. Xavier's, in the MMR. where it was a leadership workshop, and every one of us was asked to raise their hand and tell each of us that what would that person become in the next 10 years? What is the goal of that person in the next 10 years? And I still remember that I was the only one who raised my hand, and I stood up and said that I want to be a wildlife photographer in the next 10 years. And that's how the determination began, and that's how the journey started. So today I have actually been working as a naturalist and a wildlife photographer in Assam since the past 2 years. And I think I am living a dream life of a wildlife photographer, because I was with nature constantly there for the last 2 years. Now, because of COVID, I am stuck home, and I still feel very bad that I cannot get out in the field, and I can't wait to go and shoot wildlife outside. So that is what it means for me to be a wildlife photographer. So now I'm going to just tell you about photography. I'm not going to give you any technical knowledge, or very deep technical knowledge about photography. I'm just going to give you some basics, teach you some basics, some fundamentals about photography. So the first question that comes to our mind when we think of photography seriously is, what camera should I choose when I start photography? So the answer is the one which is available, or the one which fits your budget. So here I have put a DSLR and a phone. So both of them are really important in photography. If you have access to even a phone, you can do wonders with the phone, using a phone as a tool for photography, because the cameras of smartphones have become so phenomenal that now you can capture amazing images, or even shoot using a phone, even film an entire film on a phone. So the technology has reached, I think, to a level where you can use phone for serious photography. And definitely after the phone, you should graduate to a proper camera. If you have the budget, if you really are into it, if you can save up enough money and buy a camera for yourself, nothing like it. So first, I think you should start with a phone and then move on to a camera. And now the tips that I'm going to tell you, it's not just about the phone, about the camera. It is also applicable to the people who are using phones for doing photography. So this picture here is of a rhino in Kaziranga grassland, and I have shot this on my phone. So I use a OnePlus 6 right now, and this picture has been shot on a phone. Even this picture here has been shot on a phone that is taken in Meghalaya in Doki, which the water there is crystal clear. You can see the rocks, the river bed inside, and that's where I've taken this picture. This has also been shot on the phone. So now we move to the basics of photography. Like, what is the fundamentals that you should know when you are taking a picture? And that is the exposure triangle. So what is the exposure triangle? So this has three parts to it. So exposure is the light that you get in an image, and using the camera you can control that light. So once you know these three basic things, or you understand the exposure triangle, you can take better pictures. So first is aperture. So in a camera there is always a ring which lets light pass into the camera. So this is like a tiny hole, and this is the aperture of the camera. And as you change the number, the ring will open or shut close, and it depends how much light will pass inside the camera. So here in the picture you can see, if you see my cursor here, you can see that this is wide open and this is like almost closed. There is a small pinhole where the light is passing through. So if less light will pass, definitely you know that the picture will be dark, and if more light will pass, the picture will have a lot of light. So according to the situation, according to what you are taking picture of, you have to change the aperture. So also the aperture helps in determining the depth of field. So what is the depth of field? So depth of field is the shallowness or the depth of the field. So if you consider eyes, if you see something in front of you, if that is in focus, something beyond it will look a little blur to you. And then you focus on that. If you see a lot more things, then everything will be clear. So similarly, if you keep the aperture wide open, you will get a considerable amount of depth and only certain object will be in focus. So in our phones also, we have now two lenses. One is a normal lens and the other one is the portrait mode. So the portrait mode enables you to capture pictures which have a background which is blurred. And that background blur is possible because of the depth of field and that particular lens that has been given to us. And in professional cameras or DSLRs, you have the technology in the lens itself or in the camera itself to allow the light to pass inside it. So you can see in the example here, the cheese is completely focused. Then the rat is blurred and the cat here is completely blurred in the shallow depth of field. But when you have the aperture being closed and you let less light pass, then the depth, you can see here that everything is almost here in focus. So the aperture controls the shallowness or the deepness of the field, the depth of the field. So this is the first part. The second part is shutter speed. So shutter speed is nothing but the speed at which the mirror closes or the shutter clicks. You hear that sound, catch, khachak, we say that. So that is the shutter speed. So the amount of time you allow the shutter to remain open determines the amount of light entering the sensor or the camera. So if you have an exposure of 1/2, then there will be a lot of light entering. If you have an exposure of 1/1000, less light will enter. And if the mirror clicks faster at 1/1000, and the mirror will click very slow at 1/2. So you can see the effect of shutter speed here. Because of slow shutter speed, you will get motion. So the rat is running and the cat is also running. They are not very sharp. You will get certain kind of motion with slow shutter speed. And if you have fast shutter speed, then you can freeze the action. You can freeze the motion. You can see the cat and the mouse here. They are completely frozen in action. And that is possible by using fast shutter speed. And you can use this shutter speed in a number of ways. It also determines the amount of light entering the camera. So everything is related to light. Aperture is related to light. It will determine how much light enters the camera. Shutter speed is also related to light. It will determine how much light enters the camera. And the third one is ISO. So ISO is the sensitivity of the camera to control the light. So what happens if we have a shutter speed of 1/100 and we have an aperture of f2.8, and depending on the situation outside, we will require some amount of light. So to add that light, we will increase the ISO or we will decrease the ISO if you want to decrease the light. But adding or decreasing the ISO will determine the amount of digital noise. That is, you will get a grainy picture. You will not have very sharp picture. You might have pixels that are seen in the picture, and that is possible because of an ISO. So you have a depth, like you have a ISO of 100 and then you have a ISO of 6400. It can go beyond that also, but this determines the noise in the frame and also the light. So if you increase the ISO to 400, more light will be coming. If you increase the ISO to 1600, more light will come. But it also depends on the other factors, that is aperture and shutter speed. So here in proper sunlight, we will require less ISO, that is 100. And that's why we can see the cat and the mouse clearly here. But here, if it is night, if it is dark, then we will require more ISO. We will have to put the ISO to around 3200, 6400 to get that light. So that's why you will see that there are grains in the picture here. So the picture is not perfect. It is not very sharp. You will have some pixelation in the frame, but that is allowed. That is like considered. So sometimes you have to use external light to avoid increasing ISO. And all these things, all these three things are interrelated. So this is the exposure triangle here. And it's a bit of a complicated diagram, I would say, but you can understand here. This is the aperture here where my cursor is moving, f2.8, and it is f22 here. So at f2.8, you can have ISO of 100, and that would be enough to get the amount of light. And the shutter speed can be around 1 by 250 or more than that. So if you increase the ISO to 200, then you have to decrease the aperture at 1 by f4. And then you have to also decrease the shutter speed. So all of this is interrelated. And it also depends on the external light or the actual light that we are shooting at. So all these concepts, I would say you will get in touch with them, or you will understand with them once you start taking pictures. Once you start taking pictures, you will slowly start understanding this. Photography is a process of learning, and it is a process of never ending learning. You will constantly learn something new as you progress in the field. Now we move on to the concept of composition. So of you must have heard the rule of thirds. So in photography, when we are taking a picture, we will always try to keep the object on a point of thirds here. So if you see the grid here, you will see that there are some points here where these lines are meeting. And these points are where you have to compose, or you have to keep your subject there, and rest of the frame, whatever is the negative space, will be around that. So this is the basic rule of photography, and rules are meant to be broken. It is not a hard and fast rule that you have to follow this rule, but usually people who will be doing photography will follow this basic rule, that is the rule of thirds. The second is the leading lines way of composition. So when we look at an object, we are drawn inside the frame, or we are drawn inside the photo depending on how it's composed. The composition determines if the photo is appreciated by the viewer, or the photo is enough to draw attention of the viewer. So here we have the leading lines composition. So if you see here, the Eiffel Tower is here in the center, but that picture has been taken from far. But our eyes still go to the Eiffel Tower because it is the subject, or it is in the center of the frame. And the way the picture has been taken is by the way of leading lines, where you can see the ground below that is completely going towards the Eiffel Tower. It is like they are stemming out of the Eiffel Tower, the lines. So that's the way it is composed. Even if you look at a railway track, for that matter, from far, you will see that there is a point where the two tracks, which are parallel to each other, will vanish and meet at a point that is for our eyes. So that point is where the subject should be. And when two parallel lines meet together at a vanishing point, that's where our subject is. And that's why the Eiffel Tower is in the center. And if you imagine these white lines, in the end, they will meet at that point. So that is the leading lines way of composition. These composition techniques are to draw the attention of the viewer. Then symmetry. Symmetry is also one of the simplest forms of composition, usually used in architecture. Whenever we also like we build something, also we try to maintain architectural structure, we'll always have some kind of a symmetry. It is not a hard and fast rule to follow that, but usually people do follow symmetry because it is pleasing to the eye. And that's why you can see it is also followed in photography. And you can see that this is a completely symmetrical picture. If you divide it in two halves, you will have identical or mirror images of each other. So that is symmetry. Then foreground and focus. So we have two composition techniques in this part of the slideshow. So foreground focus. So foreground focus is keeping the subject in the foreground and also giving importance to the background. So here the subject is the chain here, or the hinge that you see here is the subject that is in focus, but the background is also as important as the subject. And you can see the city which is blurred, but you can still see that where you can get a sense of place where this picture has been taken or by the picture. So that is called foreground in focus, giving importance to the subject but also giving importance to the habitat or the place where that subject is located. So that is foreground in focus. Then frame within a frame. So we capture a frame using our cameras. We can also capture a frame within a frame. That is also one of the most common ways of composition, usually in architectural photography, or where we go, if we, like you must have seen a lot of pictures maybe of the Taj Mahal, where the Taj Mahal is in the frame inside one of the arches and you can see the Taj Mahal behind. The subject is obviously the Taj Mahal, but the frame is adding to the subject. It is making the subject eye pleasing. So these are the few of the rules of composition. So now we move on to understanding light. If you have any questions, do put them in the comments. After the session, I will be answering those questions. So this is the basic understanding of light. Understanding light is one of the most difficult things, I would say, in photography, and that will only come with experience. In this diagram, you will see there are four types of lights that are explained: front light, above light, back light, and lateral light. So the sun is considered the major source of light in this picture. It can be an artificial source of light as well. Then we have the camera here, and then we have the subject. So if the light is coming from behind and it is falling on the subject, then it is called as front light. So the subject is standing in the way of light and the camera is in the middle. You can see it from the diagram. Then the second is above light. If the light source is above the subject, if the light is coming from top, back light is the light which is behind the subject. So if the light source is behind the subject and subject is in the middle of the light source and the camera, then that is the backlight. And then we have lateral light, wherein the light is coming from an angle on the subject, left or right angle. So these are some of my photographs that I'm showing now. So this is the fan-throated lizard. This is an example of front light. So the light was coming from behind the camera. So I was taking the picture, the sun was behind me and the light was directly falling on the fan-throated lizard. So that's how you can see a very even light on the subject. This is backlight, and the technique that I have used here is rim lighting. So rim lighting is the use of backlight and showing the light is there around the subject. So it's entirely dark. The scene is completely dark, but there is some light coming, which is the backlight. It is from an artificial source here. This is a chameleon, and I have captured this in the Western Ghats. And you can see the structure of the chameleon because of the light. So this is called rim lighting, using a very thin light or backlight to highlight the subject. Then this is backlight, wherein the sun has risen behind the deer. So the deer I have photographed from the front, the light source is behind the subject. But I have used the light in such a way to create a silhouette of the subject and to show the dreamy image here using the light. And this is low-key lighting. So using very less light and using that to expose the subject, but the rest of the background or the negative space that is there, that is completely dark. Only this is using an artificial light source. I have captured this. This is also around Mumbai. This is in Mathiran. I have captured this snake. This is a green vine snake. So this is low-key lighting. So these are some of the lighting techniques that you use in photography. You will understand all these techniques once you start taking pictures. Now we come to one of the most critical part of photography, and that is post-processing. So post-processing is editing the photos. So now softwares have allowed us to edit our photos and enhance them so that the viewer finds it more eye-pleasing to depict the best colors possible. You can use these softwares and enhance your photos. So these are the softwares that I use. This is Adobe Camera Raw. This is a software which is given by Adobe. And the cameras, usually the professional cameras, will take pictures in the raw format so that you can have a lot of information stored in the file, and you can use that information in the software to get a lot of details back into the image. So that is Adobe Camera Raw. And then I also use Adobe Photoshop and Adobe Lightroom as well. So these are some of the software which are given to us. I also use Snapseed. Snapseed is a software which is easily available on Play Store. And that I use for my phone and all the pictures that I've edited on the phone. All the pictures that I've taken on the phone, the Snapseed app allows you to do a lot of things. But there is a very thin line between photo manipulation and photo processing. So what I do is just enhance the picture. I don't change the elements of the picture. So this is the workflow. This is Adobe Camera Raw, which is the software given by Adobe. And it is very simple. It is just a few sliders here. If you can see my cursor here, you can see these sliders. You can just increase, decrease the slider, move the slider, play around with it, and achieve results that you like. So that is the Adobe Camera Raw software. Then the software opens the photograph in Photoshop. And you can do much more in Photoshop using the adjustments that you can do in Photoshop. So this is the raw photograph that I have captured in the camera. So this is from the camera, directly from the camera, and opened that in the software. Now I will show what I have done with the picture. So you can see there is a distracting element here. This is where the monkey was sitting. That this is the lion-tailed macaque, which I have photographed in South India, in Western Ghats. And here you see they are sitting on the roof of a house. But I did not want that because that I felt is unnatural. So I cropped the image. So I cropped the image and I composed it like that. And you can see the original colors. I have just enhanced the colors so that it becomes more eye-pleasing. And I also took a creative liberty and made it into black and white. And I have added some noise to it. So I've added noise so that it looks more artistic. So that's what you can achieve using these apps or these softwares. And you can also change a lot of things. You can remove elements from the frame, but that in nature photography, that is, I feel, is not allowed. If you are doing that, you should always mention that. This is a simple explanation of white balance, which you can achieve in post-processing if you're taking a raw image. This is by ace photographer Sudhir Shivram, and you can see the Kelvin or the white balance, which allows the yellow light or the blue light. So white balance here is 10,000 Kelvin and the scene is completely yellow. But if you have a white balance of 2500 Kelvin, you'll get a blue effect. So you can change the white balance. If you see the slider here, the temperature slider, the blue and the yellow, you can change that and you can achieve what looks good for you. So that's what I wanted to tell. So this is just the basic things of post-processing that I wanted to share. And now I want to talk about the most important thing, that is a photographer's perspective. So what is a photographer's perspective? So the perspective of the photographer is the way a photographer thinks. The way a photographer thinks when he is capturing the image. So here I have mentioned certain things, that is thinking differently, concept of pre-visualization, trying out out-of-the-box angles, moving beyond the traditional approach, and practice making you better, and what is a good photo versus a great photo. So you will see a lot of photos. Right now, we are living in such a world that everyone is a creator. Everyone is taking a photograph. You have a camera, you have a phone, you have an iPad, you are just going and taking a picture. Sometimes you don't even think when you are taking a picture. But what should you do to make your pictures stand out when people see that? What should you do to draw a viewer's attention to your photographs? So these are some of the things that you should practice or you should do to make your pictures better. So thinking differently. So everyone is taking traditional photos. Everyone is taking in wildlife photography, for say, they will go and take a close-up of a bird. Yeah, it is attractive. Everyone will like to see a close-up, the details of an animal or a bird. But what can you do to make it different? You have to think differently. Take a habitat shot. Take a shot which is completely out of the box. And think differently. Think from the perspective of the subject. When you are doing portrait photography, think how you can improve the light, what kind of backlight you can you use. So photography is an art form, and it will only improve if you put a lot of efforts in it. It's not just making great good photos by taking normal traditional photos. It is about taking photos which will engage the viewer. Then the concept of pre-visualization. So what is pre-visualization? So if you are going to photograph something, you will have something in your mind. You will have some kind of thought about the subject. You will always have some kind of visualization that you will make of the frame. So you should always use this technique if you are going out in the field or if you are going out for an assignment. Pre-visualize. Think about the frame. Think about the outcome or think about how you want the frame. Think about what are the elements that will go into the frame. Think about how it will look finally. In your thoughts, you can also draw it using a pencil, a pen on a paper. You can draw that. It doesn't have to be a very beautiful picture. It can be stick figures, but you can pre-visualize the frame. And that will always help you to make better frames. Obviously, everything cannot be in your control when you are in the field or when you are doing an assignment, but still you can pre-visualize and get that out of the line. You don't have to think again to make that picture. You have already thought about it. Then try out of the box angles. So there are safe shots and then there are out of the box shots. So you have to take the safe shots. Obviously, you will take the best photographs, but also try angles which are completely out of the box. So if you're taking a portrait and there is a plant in front of you, you can take the camera behind the leaves and take the photograph by focusing on the subject and getting that blur in front of the camera, or use crystals maybe in front of the camera to get a bokeh or a different effect. So try something else. Don't just take traditional photographs. Don't stick to the safe shots. move beyond, and after taking the safe shots, take shots which are out of the box. Move beyond the traditional approach. So that's what I was talking about, that you don't have to get stuck in the same thing. You don't have to follow the same things to take good photographs. You can do something else, do something creative, and take a unique photo. Practice makes you better. Obviously, this will not come easily. This will take years of practice. So you have to constantly take photographs, constantly try and make an effort to take good photographs. Then what is a good photo versus a great photo? So a good photo is a photo which is well composed, which is very sharp, and which will fetch you a compliment, maybe, oh wow, this is amazing. But the great photo is a photo which will ask the viewer a question that, oh, how is it possible? The viewer will ask the question, oh, how is this possible? How has this photograph been taken? What is this real? This is what should go into the viewer's mind. So taking great photographs is very, very difficult. Everyone can take a good photo. Everyone can take a well-composed, sharp, and a photo which will say, oh, this is amazing. This is wow. This is out of this is extraordinary. But it has to be out of the box. It has to be something which will, when the viewer sees that, will say, oh, I can't imagine how this photograph has been taken. So that is the difference between a good photo and a great photo. I hope all of you are following what I was saying. So that concludes the photography part of it, the basics of photography. And now I'm moving towards what kind of work I have been doing since the past few years. So I have been doing photography since last 7 years, and I have got the opportunity to do different kinds of photography. I have done event photography, I have done product photography, I have done fashion shoots, I have done a documentary photography, and the most, like the one that I like, is wildlife photography. Obviously, that is the first love. I have tried to do that. So now I'm going to show you what I was doing since the past few years. So this is documentary photography that I have done in Assam. So last 2 years, I have been working in a river cruise in the Brahmaputra landscape in Assam. So Brahmaputra is a major river that flows in India. I think all of you know that. And I was fortunate enough to work on a river cruise there. So this is the river cruise, MV Mahabahu. I was working on this river cruise as a naturalist and a destination manager. So I was doing a job of tour guide and a person who bridges the gap between nature and people. So that's what I was doing there. And you can see this is the cruise which runs in the Brahmaputra. So this is my workplace. And this is the map of Assam. So this, you can see in the center here, is the Brahmaputra River. And that river is coming from Tibet, and then it comes into Arunachal Pradesh, and then it flows into Assam, and then it goes down to Bangladesh. So here you can see the river flowing in the state. So this is like a backbone of the state, or the lifeline of the state. And I was lucky enough to work on this river. This is known as the mighty Brahmaputra. And you will see that through the pictures that I have taken. So this is the scene of the river. So when you go on that river, you will imagine, like, you cannot imagine how big that river is, how vast that river is in size. So the one bank to the other bank distance can be 10 to 15 kilometers wide. You can't even see the opposite bank sometimes. So that's how wide the river is. In some places it is narrow. It is narrowest at Guwahati, that is 1 kilometer. But in some places it is quite wide. It's like an ocean in itself. So these are some of the sailboats, fishing boats, which have put sails because of the strong winds that were blowing there. And this is an ever-changing landscape. So you must have heard about the floods that have happened in Assam recently because of the monsoon. And it happens every year. Every year the river floods. And because of the floods, a lot of people lose their lives. They lose their livelihoods. They have to change where they are living. They have to shift from there. It is an ever-changing landscape. But it is also giving life. to the people there. It is a lifeline there because it helps in agriculture, which is the major occupation there. So this is when the river is starting to rise. Just before monsoon, as the snow melts from the Himalayas, the river starts rising. This is also the river rising and taking away the sand banks. So a lot of sand comes inside the river and then sand banks are formed. It's like beach. It's like a beach in the middle of a river. Everywhere you'll have sand banks. But these sand banks are temporary structures. They will, as the river goes down or the recedes, then these sand banks will come up. And as the river starts rising again because of the snowmelt and because of rain, then these sand banks vanish. So this is where when the river has started rising and the sand is falling inside the river. This is an island in the middle of the river, one of the islands in the river. And there is a hut here. People live there. There is also a mosque there and people go and worship there. And when the river rises, the sand that you see around here, all that will vanish. This is the structures or the shape that the sandbanks would make. You can see how vast or how huge the river is. This is just one picture where you can see the bank, the river bank, and you can see the animals here, the cows. The cows are normal size, normal cows, and you can see how like diminutive they can be seen because of the size of the sandbank. This is one scene where this is like a small pond or a lake that has been formed because of the river. This is known as a beel. B-double-E-L. And you must have learned in history class in schools about rafts, about bamboo rafts, how like ancient man used rafts to make and transport from one end to the other in water or in river. You can actually see that happening in the Brahmaputra. Here, bamboo is one of the major cash crops, and to transport these bamboos through the river, they will make a raft and they will live on this raft for a few days and they will transport that to another place using the river. And they will cook their food there. They will catch fish from the river and cook it in that small hut that you see. They will live on the raft for a few days. So you can actually see these things in the Brahmaputra. And this is a structure which is built by the people to stop the erosion that happens because of the changing nature of the river. This is known as bandalling. And this is a picture which I've taken in during sunset where I could capture the silhouette here. This is people fishing in the river, and these are fishing traps which are made out of bamboo. And this is a fishing net, or a Chinese fishing net as it is known. Which you can see very commonly in the river. This is a fishing boat. This is the wavy nature of the river. And these are people who are using the boats to transport from one end to the other in the river. But it is very difficult because the river's flow or the current is very, very strong. This is one of the places or the villages which is on the banks of the river. And these are boats which they have made using wood, which they use for fishing. Now we move to the civilization, the people living there. That was a landscape. The Bangla speaking villages. The people who are living here are different types. We have tribal people. We have people who are the Bangla people. When India got independent, India was divided into India and Pakistan. But one more part of our nation was divided, and that became the Eastern Bengal region, and later it became Bangladesh. And that Eastern Bengal is connected to West Bengal and to Assam, and this is the border state. So a lot of Bangla people also inhabit this landscape. They live on the banks of the Brahmaputra. So these images are from those villages. So these are the people. They are like very simple people who are using that land. This is one of the best lands for agriculture. It is said that people take this soil home, back home, to try using that for agriculture. It is so fertile. And that is because of the floods that happen every year. So they use this soil and they grow as many crops as possible there. And you can see here the shifting nature of the river, how that sandbank has fallen. So this is not a permanent structure. These sandbanks, and the entire village can completely go, they can entirely fall inside that river's water. So most of the life around the banks of the river is temporary. People have adapted to the changing nature and they are living in huts, because that is the most, like I would say, a feasible way of living. Using bamboos, using wood, making their houses, if you can see here, using that. And they can shift that whenever they want. If they feel that it's unsafe there, they will shift that. This I have captured in a school, school structure on these islands. There are a lot of islands there where people live. And this is inside the school. I was in the school. I was looking, I was interacting with the children, and I saw that a woman, I think one of the child's mother, was peeping and seeing what is happening there. And that's when I clicked this picture. This is one of the portraits of the Bangla lady there. This is their house, inside the house. So you can see how simply they live. Obviously, now they have LPG gas connections because of the government schemes, but they still prefer to use firewood, and it goes to waste. So this is actually made out of jute wood. The hut is made out of jute wood. Jute is a cash crop. The gunny bags that we have, that is made out of jute. So here you can see the remainder of that is actually used to make the walls of the houses, and it is also used as firewood. This is a chulha, which has been made out of mud, and that's where she is cooking. This is a small place where she is grinding her like masalas and everything on that. So that is how simply they live. And these are toys which are made out of wood. So you can see how they are living a very simple life. Nothing has come and touched them. I think I would say they have not got corrupted with technology. It's very simple. This is an Assamese man who's praying. So they have a very different culture there, and I would talk about that as we move ahead. So you can see that he's praying inside a private temple, which is there in every house. Now we go to the Mishings. The Mishings are the tribal people who are living on the banks of the river Brahmaputra. And they are Tibeto-Burman people. So they have a Mongoloid face. So if you see that man's face here, you can see the Mongoloid features here. And that is the Mongoloid feature which has come to the entire northeast from the Yunnan province of China or from Burma. Over the years, the migrations that have happened there, that the Tibeto-Burman feature or the Mongoloid feature has been passed down. So these are the Mishing people, which have a very peculiar Mongoloid face, which you can see. And they live on houses which are made on stilts. So because of the rising water, they have adapted in such a way that they make their houses on bamboo poles or stilts. And you can see the huts completely simple, like only the roofs now have changed to tin roofs because they protect better from the rain. And some places you find these cement poles. But that doesn't mean that they don't have money to build the houses, or they don't have money to pursue something else. This is a bike here, a Royal Enfield bike, and very new bike, which has been bought by the person who lives inside this house. That means that he has the money to buy that bike, but this is just a way of living. So that doesn't mean that they are poor or anything. That means this is their way of life. And inside the hut, you can see how this hut is made. It is all made out of the bamboo, and the flooring is also bamboo. This is the fireplace or the place where they cook their food. This is where they smoke their food. They are pork eaters, so they smoke their pork here. And they are also like making food here. They also make their own alcohol, which I'll talk about. So I told that they are pork eaters. So they breed pigs, or they breed a lot of pigs, and they sell that for money in the market. And these are hand pumps, which are the source of water there, because water, groundwater is easily available. They will use this to drink also. It's filtered through the sand and they will use that to drink. And here they are taking small piglets to the town or to the city, where they will be selling that for money in the gunny bags. And this is how they make their flour. They are grinding it using traditional techniques. And you can see in this image here, this man is talking on a phone, and here they are weaving something. So weaving is a culture in Assam, and that has been passed down from generation to generation. And you can see the touch of modernity and still the tradition happening in this particular photo. So here the man has just dismantled the house because he's going to shift the house, and he is shaving himself, like his beard and all. And I have captured a very candid moment there. This is a silhouette where she is actually sitting on a handloom, which where she is making handlooms or the cloth, the weaving material there. And this is a daughter and a mother. So the daughter is learning from the mother there. So this is what they weave, and this is a beautiful pattern that is very unique to that tribe. So a lot of these tribes there, they will have their own weaving technique, and they will have their own patterns, which you will not find anywhere. So it's very rich in that kind of culture. So this is all made on hand loom. It is no machine is involved in this. These are young boys there, and this is their toy. This is made out of, you can see, bottles, plastic bottles, switchboards. These are rubber out of the sandals or slippers. You cut that rubber out and make the wheel of the vehicle. So that's how they are making their toys. So you can see innovation here also. And all these kids are going to temporary schools in these islands, because these islands can vanish because of floods. All these structures are temporary, but they have been given opportunities to learn by the government. Schools are there almost everywhere we have been. And they make their own alcohol also. So this is hooch. Obviously, this is illegal, but no one is going to come and question them. So this is what they are making there. But they also have rice beer, which is part of their culture. And that's how they make rice beer as well. And this man is drinking rice beer, which is part of their tradition. So that is about the Mishing tribal people. And these are the economics of the Brahmaputra Valley or the region. They use jute. So this is the jute fiber, which comes from the crop. And we also go to, like, during that journey, we go to the jute mill there. And I have captured these photos inside a jute mill. So now this is a dying business because plastic has taken over. But still, they will make gunny bags there, and this is how it is being made. All these are very old machinery from the colonial times, which still exists there. And these workers are dependent on the mill to give them the livelihood there. And they are making more than 10,000 bags every day, 10,000 gunny bags. You can see these bags here. All these are gunny bags. Everything you can see in that jute mill, the process of sewing the gunny bags as well. Then tea. I think all of you know about tea, which comes from Assam tea. So tea estates are also part of this landscape. And these are some of the tribal people who are working in the tea estate. This is also from a tea estate. You will get some beautiful landscape shots when you go to the tea estate. Also, some interactions with the people who actually work there. So these are the people who are after, like, the sun sets, they are going back to their home. Now we move to the culture. So the very rich in culture, the entire Northeast is very rich in culture, and Assam particularly. So this is Bihu. Bihu is the state dance of Assam. And that is also the state festival of Assam. And these are the girls and boys which perform Bihu during the festival. That is like a New Year festival for them. And it is also celebrated like totally three times in a year. And these are instruments which are used in Bihu. This is the buffalo horn, which is used. And the cloths that you see here, the clothes are all made out of silk. Very like the silk which is only found in Assam, golden silk or Muga silk. So this is the culture. This is the masked performance that happened there in Assam. So you can see tradition, like stories from the Ramayana, from the Mahabharata are being performed in Assam. And that is all like using masks. So you can see that tradition everywhere in Assam. And this is particularly known from the Majuli Island, which is the largest inhabited river island in the world. And that is the cultural hub of Assam. So this is from the play that they do of Ramayana. And this is the Sita Haran or the kidnapping of Sita scene. And this is the dance that they do, Satriya dance, this is the Dashavatar dance that they do. So this is performed by the girls there. They do different incarnations of Lord Vishnu. So, and there is also like a culture of monks there. And these monks are Hindu monks. These monks are actually the worshippers of Lord Vishnu. They consider Lord Vishnu from the Trinity of the Hindu religion to be their central god. And they worship him and his incarnations. So there are temples which are actually monasteries. And these monks, Hindu monks, live in these monasteries. And some of them are actually celibate monasteries. The monks are not allowed to marry. They choose and they come and live there. They can pursue everything. They can like pursue their hobbies. They can pursue education. Everything is possible. But just that they are not allowed to marry. And they have to lead a life of a monk. And these monks have a dance or a prayer dance that they perform. So this is known as the Satriya dance, the prayer dance which they do for Lord Vishnu. And that is using the drums. And this is their traditional dress that they wear during this dance. So this is the temple, the gate of the temple. You can see how colorful it is. And these are the monks who are performing that dance. And this dance can only be experienced. It's very difficult to talk about that through photos, but you can just experience that. And this is a place of worship. This is a temple of Lord Vishnu or a monastery or a satra. So these are some of the pictures from there. And now to the beautiful part of Assam, that is sunset that I've seen there. So these are on the Brahmaputra River. And every day you get to see one of the most beautiful sunset. So these are some of the particular photos that I have selected for this slideshow. Yes. So these are the sandbanks and you can see the sun setting and the river here. And these are the hues of the sunset. After the sun is set, all the colors that come. These are all the sandbanks here. And in the sandbanks, you can see that water has gone inside these sandbanks or it is still drying. So the water is still there. And a fishing boat is moving in the river. And this is from Bangladesh. So I was really lucky to go to Bangladesh as well using the river, using the Brahmaputra. From Guwahati, we completely sailed down through Bangladesh. And then we went to Kolkata through the Bay of Bengal. And that time I was able to document a lot of parts of Bangladesh. I've not included that in the slideshow, but I've just included 2-3 photos. So this is street photography or photography that I could do there. So this is handloom is a very big culture in Bangladesh as well. This is the boats. Bangladesh is a country of rivers. We don't know a lot about Bangladesh. There are a lot of misconceptions about the country. But once you experience the country after going there, you will, I think a lot of people will change their perception about Bangladesh. And these are the boats there on one of the ports, the major ports, and people live on these boats. This is part of their livelihood. Then I was also able to go to Nagaland and document the festival, the Hornbill festival there. So the tribal people also have gone and seen the tribal people in Nagaland there. So that is also very rich. I've not included that here in the slideshow. I'm going to share some links later after the slideshow is done so that you can see more of my work. Now we move on to nature and wildlife photography. First to the landscapes that I have captured. when obviously when you are in such a beautiful natural environment, you get chance to take pictures of landscapes as well. So this is a scene from Kaziranga National Park, the grasslands, the never-ending grasslands of elephant grass or the very tall grass that you see there. So this is from there, a sunrise from there. And then we have the Himalayas seen from Kaziranga National Park. So it is very difficult to see these Himalayas. It is only possible if it is a very clear day, there is no pollution in between. You can actually see Himalayas from the riverside or from Kaziranga. You can see Himalayas of Arunachal Pradesh. So these are the Tawang Himalayas. Tawang is a place in Arunachal Pradesh. You can see these Himalayas from Assam, from other state. So during lockdown, I think because of the pollution level went down, some places were there from Punjab also, you can see the Himalayas. So here the pollution is very less. You can see the Himalayas, I think throughout the year, when if it is a clear day, you will be lucky, you might get to see. This is landscape of Kaziranga National Park, water logged areas because of the floods that happen, wetland areas. And this is the Brahmaputra River, the when the river is going down. This is a sunset in Kaziranga National Park with the hills that are there near the park. This is a Milky Way which I have actually captured in Ladakh. So I have actually roamed around the entire country, not just Assam, the entire country to capture different things. So in wildlife photography, you will see all that. So this is a landscape or a Milky Way which I captured in Ladakh. There you have clear skies. This is in the Himalayas. So this is a cloud forest, the evergreen forest of the Himalayas. One more photo of the cloud forest. This is in Meghalaya, the land of waterfalls. So this is of the Vaisadong fall or the three-step fall that you see. And this is the Nokhalikhai falls in Meghalaya. Meghalaya is also very rich in natural heritage. Now we move to birds. This is the Oriental Dwarf Kingfisher, the first photograph that I showed you. And this is this kingfisher is known to capture insects, anything that it can get to eat. And this is during its breeding season I have captured. This is this kingfisher is going to feed that to its babies. So this is a small skink or a lizard that it has captured. This is the Indian paradise flycatcher. So these are some of the colorful birds that I have captured over the years. This has been captured in Mumbai, and this also has been captured in Mumbai. This is in Mumbai as well, Indian blue robin in Matheran Hills. This is flamingos. I think everyone knows about flamingos. These are lesser flamingos, which I have actually captured in New Mumbai or Navi Mumbai in the Nehru region. These are pelicans from Kaziranga, a habitat shot. So a habitat shot is to show where the actual subject is so that you get a sense of place also along with the subject. This is a darter bird or a snake bird. This is a traditional photograph. This is a bird which captures fish, like a cormorant, a bird which captures fish. And this is a photograph after like examining to show the sense of place here, a habitat shot where it was sitting with the tree which has a lot of flowers, and you can see the darter sitting. So this is what you can do. Like, you can compose different frames by observing the subject, and you can observe the environment and compose different frames. These are ruddy shell ducks sitting on the banks of the river Brahmaputra. So not just people, a lot of wildlife is also seen on the banks of river Brahmaputra. This is in a park. You can see parrots here, rose and parrot. But if you observe the photograph carefully, if you see here in the corner where my cursor is moving, there is a monitor lizard. A monitor lizard which is going to actually come to their nest. This is their nest here, and it is going to eat its chicks, their chicks or eggs. So they are very wary of the monitor lizard. They are trying to get it away. This is a blue-throated barbet, another colorful bird. This is an Indian roller. This I've captured in Arunachal Pradesh, we can see the Himalayas in the background here. A Kashmiri pheasant, great hornbill, it is tossing the berry here. Shubham, do we have enough time? Can you tell me about the time?
So we are 10 minutes over time. So if you could start wrapping up, that would be great.
Okay. So I'm just going to move a little fast now. And I'll just show the pictures. I will not explain a lot of things. So here you see a white-tailed eagle, which is flying, one of the largest eagles. And you can see this is a jungle crow. So you can get a sense of the size of the eagle here. This has been captured on the Brahmaputra banks. Another eagle, the gray-headed fish eagle. This is all from Assam, the Asian barred owlet from Assam. This is a habitat shot of an owl, which I've taken in the city. So to show that it is part of the city, I took a wider perspective and I showed there is a bridge behind, and this owl is actually sitting on a bamboo pole and hunting insects in the night. Another photograph of the brown hawk owl, one of the brown hawk owl portraits. This is a rufous-necked hornbill which I've captured in Himalayas. So we have a lot of wildlife in our country. The oriental dwarf kingfisher again with the lizard kill. These are the red-breasted parakeets which you can see in Kaziranga. A black and white photo to show the kingfishers, which are black and white in color, the pied kingfishers. Now we move to macro. So there are different things in wildlife as well, birds. Then we have insects, that is the macro life, insects, reptiles, which is also part of macro. And then we have mammals, which I've kept in the end. So this is the butterflies, which are mud puddling. So they are taking salts from the ground. And I've taken a habitat shot to show the mountains behind. This is also a habitat shot of a butterfly with the stream. So the stream is flowing. It is not just important to show the close-up of the butterfly, but also show where it is there, which habitat it inhabits. A butterfly, a colorful butterfly. This is a close-up again. This is extreme close-up to show the patterns of the butterfly. This is a turtle on the banks of the river Brahmaputra with the habitat. And this is a portrait of a chameleon. These are frogs, some of the endangered frogs which I have captured in the Western Ghats. So it is not, wildlife photography is not only about the art, it is also about documentation. There are some rare species which you get to document. This is a frog which is actually blowing its bubble. All these frogs are only seen in monsoon, and that too in Western Ghats, with only some pockets of the Western Ghats that are very endangered. This is a false gliding frog. Sometimes you get to capture action also in wildlife. So you can see a snake which is feeding on fish. So from the river, it has captured a fish. This is taken on the banks of the river Brahmaputra. So it is actually going to like take the entire fish inside its mouth, is going to gulp it down. This is a Burmese python. And you can do some creative photography also. So sometimes I think people get scared of snakes, but it is nothing to fear. They are also beautiful creatures. And you can show these patterns of the Burmese python. These are tadpoles of a frog swimming in the water. And this is actually captured in my own garden or a backyard or my window actually, where this is a small jumping spider, a spider which has captured a housefly. Here you can see ants which are eating dragonfly. So it doesn't mean that you need to go everywhere, like you have to go to a forest to take pictures. You can get wildlife photographs even in the city, even in your backyard. You just have to be observant. You can use your phone, you can use your cameras, anything, and you can document. And this is technique, the composition technique which I talked about, foreground in focus. So in the foreground we have the subject, but the background is also important here. This is the habitat shot of the subject. That is a lizard, a colorful lizard, a day gecko in the Western Ghats. This is a frog with the stream. So you can get a sense of habitat here. This is creative photography. So this dragonfly was sitting on a white wall and I captured the wing pattern of the dragonfly. So you can do creative work in wildlife as well. Again, a creative photo to show the silhouette and the atmosphere of mist. So I have captured this in a cloud forest of Western Ghats, and it's during the rain with the mist all around. So that's why it's like a blue tone to it, and a creative photograph to give a sense of atmosphere in the photograph. A creative photo of the tail of the chameleon. Now we move to the big animals, that is the mammals. So I have been lucky enough to capture different moments of a rhino's life, the one-horned rhino, which is an endangered species. So you can see them in Assam. The best place to see them is Kaziranga. So this is during sunrise, a mother rhino. This is the mother and this is a baby here, which is munching, and the sunrise happening in the grassland. Oh, sorry, this slide, I think, came forward. Yeah. And you can see the horn of the rhino, a portrait of the rhino, and a bird sitting on the back. This is a habitat shot with the grassland. You can see how big the grass is. The rhino, which is a big animal, is dwarfed by the grassland. They love to go in the mud. They wallow in the mud. They just sleep in the mud. So this is a mother and baby wallowing in the mud. And this is a rhino which is charging at me. So sometimes you must have heard that rhinos charge at you or something like that. But they are actually very, very calm animals. But the only thing that is a problem for them is that they cannot see properly. And that's why they don't perceive a threat. And that's why they might charge. But usually they are very calm. And this is rhinos engaged in the act of mating. So I could also capture the act of mating of rhinos. And this goes on for 5 to 6 hours straight in a line. There's a mother and rhino calf grazing in the waterbed of grass, and a family of rhino, mother, father, and a baby. The seeing a father with the rhino is very, very difficult, but very luckily you might see. It's a 0.1% chance you can see. So that is during that time I've captured this. This is using backlight. So I've talked about backlight. So the light was coming behind, I used that and made it into golden light and captured this portrait. This is during sunrise. So as the sun was rising, I've captured this mother and baby. And this is during sunset. The second picture is during sunset. This is during that time when you can see Himalayas from Kaziranga. And that chance happens only once a year, or two times in a year. From Kaziranga, you can see Himalayas. And I was lucky enough to capture that habitat to show Kaziranga's grasslands, the rhino, and Himalayas, which are in Arunachal Pradesh, here. The next animal, the big five from Kaziranga, are rhino, buffalo, elephant, tiger, and deer. So this is the buffalo, the white water buffalo, as well. And they have long horns. Longest horns in any of the bovine species, and they are very angry. So they are actually one of the most dangerous animals, I would say. Carnivores like tigers are less dangerous compared to herbivores like these buffaloes with big horns. Now we have the Indian elephant. So this is in the Brahmaputra River. So this is the river flowing here. This is a sand bank which is actually converted into forest. This is shrubs and the grass that grows. So you can imagine how tall the grass grows. This is a big elephant, around 20 elephant. But the grass is growing bigger than that. And then you have the trees, which is the main park. And you have the sky here. So this is a habitat shot to show the scale of the habitat. This is the tusker from Kaziranga with the long tusks. A family which is crossing the road. Baby, usually these families are matriarchal. So there are no, or young males are only there. Big males are not part of the families, or they are thrown out, or they are individuals. So here you can see they are walking on the bank, like on a very small edge. And completely dwarfed. So they come down during summer to drink water or to just dip in the water. And that current is very strong. It's very difficult. This is the Nilgiri Thar, a mountain goat, which I have captured in Western Ghats. I have taken a portrait by going very close to this animal by a wide angle lens. So that is possible. Sometimes the animals let you come very, very close and you can capture these kind of portraits. But that happens only with patience. A habitat shot of a eastern swamp deer in morning light. This is a eastern swamp deer or a Barasingha. You must have heard Barasingha or 12-horned antlered deer. So that is the Barasingha. They engage in fights like these to woo females. And that is the shot I showed you before with the backlight. And that is a silhouette. So you can use light and you can use different techniques to make creative images as well. Hawk deer in Kaziranga. Again, a hawk deer with the antlers. The Nilgiri Rangur. So I love to take photos of primates as well. Monkeys and langurs, all these species, macaques. So we have more than 20 species of primates in India. So these are some of them. The Nilgiri langur with long tail. This is from Western Ghats. The lion-tailed macaque from Western Ghats. The hulog gibbon, a habitat shot from the Northeast India. The pair of hulog gibbons. So the lighter one is the female. The darker one is the male. The golden langur, one of the most endangered primates from the Northeast India. This is the capped langur, another langur with a cap-like structure on the head. That's why it is known as a capped langur or a capped monkey. This is a northern pig-tailed macaque. So this monkey has a tail which looks like a pig's tail. Now you also get to see some action in wildlife when you are in the field or in the national park, when you go for a safari. So here you see a mongoose. So this deer is actually killed by a tiger, but the tiger has left after eating his share. But there are scavengers in the jungle. Nothing goes to waste. And this mongoose is the scavenger. It has come for an easy meal there. And it is feeding on that spotted deer carcass. A red panda. So this is one of my favorite animals. And you can actually see a red panda in the wild in India. And that is in the Himalayas. So in Himalayas, in Arunachal Pradesh, in West Bengal, we have Darjeeling and hills above that. The eastern Himalayas is a place where you can see red pandas. This is in the Himalayas in Ladakh, a marmot. So a habitat shot of the Himalayan marmot. This is a rodent species. Then we have the smooth-coated Indian otters. So otters which are on the banks of the river Brahmaputra, and you can actually see the young babies of the otters. So they live in families. And here you can see this is a den of the otters, and these are part of the family. These are the mother and the father. And here the mother is actually helping the baby out to come up because it cannot climb the sandbank. So it is lifting it up by grabbing its head very gently using its mouth. This is the river dolphin. So the aquatic life, this is the national aquatic animal of India, the Gangetic river dolphin or the South Asian river dolphin. Very difficult to capture. You can see it will jump and it will vanish in 1 second. It's very, very difficult to capture because you never know where it is coming out from. Now we move to the big cats. So I don't just love photographing the rest of wildlife, I also love big cats. So this is a lion, or the Asiatic lion, which I have captured in Gujarat in Gir National Park. And that is actually during the IV with St. Xavier's BMM department. And you can see the teeth here, or the canines of the lion when it is yawning. A tiger. So this is our national animal. And this is captured in Ranthambore in the Ranthambore National Park in India. We have the tiger. Which is a tiger cub, which is actually sipping water. A classic portrait of a tiger in Ranthambore. This is a female tigress, actually. This is the tiger which is sitting in a water hole during summer. He is drinking water using its tongue. You can see the details here. So you can do different things with wildlife. You can take close-ups, you can take habitat shots. So you don't just have to take close-ups. This is the habitat shot of a tiger where you can get a sense of place. And this is a once in a lifetime moment which I have captured. Actually, a tiger killing a wild boar and sitting in front of me and actually eating a wild boar. So I could actually capture the entire sequence. I have the entire sequence. So this is a lightning. So this is the law of nature, the survival of fittest, which I was able to observe in the wild. Sometimes you will feel very sad for the wild boar, but you also have to realize that they have to hunt for food. So that's why this image depicts raw nature. And now we come to the final bit of images. That is the golden tiger. The golden tiger, or a tabby tiger. It is a Royal Bengal tiger. And this tiger is so unique that there are no records of this tiger existing in the wild. That was these photographs came out, no one knew that this tiger existed in the wild. Only people knew that it was found in zoos. And it was like, because, but the when I got to know why this tiger existed, it is a very sad thing to know, because it is possible only because of inbreeding. Inbreeding, or like when recessive genes are expressed. So a father breeding with a daughter, or a son breeding with a mother, something like this happens, sister breeding with a mother. So inbreeding, that is not good for wildlife as well. So that is why this tiger has been born. A golden tiger with very few black stripes. You can see very few black stripes on the animal, only the yellow fur and the white fur. The black stripes are not visible, but that is possible only because of inbreeding, and that is caused due to habitat destruction. So habitat destruction is really a big concern for wildlife in India and all over the world. We are taking away their home, we are taking away and encroaching on their land. And that's why this tiger has emerged. People actually were very happy with this sighting. But let me tell you that this is not a very happy sighting. All these images went viral on social media. It was taken up by a lot of medias, and it was like in all the news. But let me tell you that this is not a happy sight. This is actually because of inbreeding and because their habitat is getting destroyed. Now we will have to conservation.
So we're running. We'll have to stop over here.
Yeah. Just give me 2 minutes. This is the last bit, actually. Last bit. Two, three photos are there. Okay.
All right, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So we'll the last bit is.
Hello. 10 minutes. So we'll stop at 6:30, and then we'll take a few questions.
Yeah. So the conservation is also important in photography. So this is conservation photography, where you see any endangered bird which actually are sitting on a dump of waste, and that is their home. That's where they get their food, and that is being taken away from them. So that is also very important. It's not just about a pretty picture. It is about a story which you can tell. Road kills that happen. Wildlife will die when vehicles hit them, because they cross, all these roads cross to their habitat. So that is about conservation photography, and that is also much more important. As much as you tell a pretty picture, you also show what is the reality. So that is all the photographs that I wanted to show. Sorry, I took a long time because there was a lot of content and short time. Sorry. So that is about, thank you very much. That's the photography that I've done till now. So any questions now, you can share them. You can tell me. I'm just stopping the screen sharing. Yes. All right. So let's now move to the questions. Yes. So if you have any questions, you can put it in the comments. And Shubham or someone from SSL, you can also like tell me the questions that have come till now. So someone has asked, how did you get paid when you were just starting out? Yeah, so it is very difficult to get paid as a photographer. As a wildlife photographer, it is impossible actually to get paid sometimes. So you have to do jobs which will actually give you money, and you invest that money into wildlife. That's what I have done. So I am actually working as a naturalist, and that job is about nature. It's about talking about or giving people an idea about nature. I'm actually like doing a job like a tour guide, talking about the landscape, and that's how I'm getting paid for that. And that money I'm investing in wildlife photography. Later, you can go and maybe make films, or you can sell your photos. But there are so many photographers out there, it is very difficult. Not just wildlife, for everything else. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Any other questions we have? Have you always been a freelancing photographer? No. So during my college time, I actually, when I was in BMM in St. Xavier's, I started a company with one of my friend, and we were making videos. We were into video production and photography. So we would like go and do assignments for a lot of clients, corporates in Mumbai, in around the country. And that what was actually giving us the bread and butter. And that money I invested in wildlife photography. So I have been doing photography. So I have that experience as well of commercial photography, product photography, event photography, fashion, everything we would do, make videos as well. So that was Blue Apple Digimedia. You can check out that. I will ask someone to share a link on the WhatsApp groups. And also, Shubham, you can share the Instagram links and YouTube link of my channel, so that people who must have like want to know more or want to see what kind of work I have been doing, you can go and see that there. Isn't Kaziranga badly affected right now? Yes, every year floods happen, and every year Kaziranga is underwater, and that is a natural process that happens. But you have to also realize that climate change is real. So climate change is happening in the world, and all of that is also affecting the floods. So we are getting more bad floods or worse floods than the years before. So the parks or the people are getting affected because of the constant flooding, the waves of floods that come. But flooding is an essential part of the Assam's and Kaziranga's ecosystem, and it will always happen. Which macro lens do setup do we purchase for mobile? So for mobile, there are a lot of lenses which come. I think you will find that on Amazon. I have like used most of the times whatever macro shots I have taken is using a macro lens or using a camera. But I know nowadays that there are some lenses which you can attach to the mobile, and you can do macro photography. Sorry, but I don't have like very much knowledge about these macro lenses, because I'm using a professional kit from the start. Like, I first started wildlife, and later I purchased these lenses so that I can do other photography in wildlife as well. Yes, any other questions? Yes, I think I think we are done like with the questions also, I guess. So thank you everyone for joining in, and sorry it extended half an hour more, because there was a lot more to talk about, not just the basics of photography, the work that I've been doing, so that you can get a sense or an idea what exactly it is like to be a photographer.
That's
what is the ideal location? Yes, ideal location to click pictures of starry night. Furthermore, should we increase the ISO for capturing stars? Okay, so this is a very good question. So see, we can see stars with our naked eyes, even from the city, but not the clear skies. For that, you have to go to a location which is far away from the city. Because in the city, you have light pollution, what is known as light pollution. There is a lot of light available everywhere. There is light, street lights, houses, everything has a light. So we don't have like clarity. The sky is not dark enough so to get a sense of the stars. So we have to move to a remote location or village where you can capture. So the best location from Mumbai, I would say, is Western Ghats, like 2 hours away. By driving, you can go to Bhandardhara, or you can go to Nanehat, which is part of the Western Ghats, or you can go like to remote villages near Karjat, or beyond that, you can actually see the stars there near the city. Or when you go to places like the Himachal Pradesh for treks, or you go to Ladakh. Ladakh is one of the best places to see a night sky. So there you can capture the night sky. And ISO, yes, you should increase ISO. It is like no one will question you if you have noise in the picture, because there are softwares which can reduce the noise. But to capture stars, you have to increase the ISO. It is a given. So no one will like say that, oh, this is a very noisy picture, because people know that you have to increase the noise to get that picture. Yes. Yes. So any other questions? I hope I have answered all the questions.
Yes, sir. I think we can wrap up here. Thank you for joining us for this workshop. It was really a very good workshop and very informative for us.
Yes. Thank yes. You, yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much for like letting me audience. I can connect because I have been a Xavierite, and just telling Xavierites what being a Xavierite means, or I actually carry that tag with pride. So till today, I tell people that, oh, I am from Xavier's, and they will recognize you wherever you go in the world. You will be recognized as a Xavierite. So I think thank you very much for the opportunity, and sorry for dragging it for so long.
No, that's not a problem at all.
Yes. And if you want to like join me on my adventures, you can always DM me on Instagram. My Instagram handle is Mayuresh_Hendre_photography. I think someone can share that on the comments. Shubham, you can share that maybe. Yeah. And also, you can join me on my YouTube channel, where I make vlogs about wildlife, about like how you can go approach in the field, what you can do in the field, all the adventures. I do it from the vlogs. Yes. So that is Way to the Wild, my YouTube channel.
Also, guys, you all can join the Social Service League. The link to join the Social Service League is in the description. You can find it there, and we look forward to having you all with us at the Social Service League. Thank you very much. So there's a question if you would like to answer that.
Yeah. So does astrophotography really work, or it's just a gimmick? Yes, it does work. It does work. It's not just about the Milky Way. You can capture the Milky Way. I think that is the most basic thing. Or you can do star trail photography. That is the most basic thing. But after that, you can also gained proficiency in that, you can get telescopes which you can attach to the cameras, and you can shoot planets. You can shoot far away galaxies like Andromeda or something. You can Orion's belt. You can show that through photographs, and that is actually real. But that requires a lot of like equipment and proficiency. To reach that level, you will have to gain a lot of experience. There are a lot of astronomy clubs here around Mumbai also. There is a club called Amateur Astronomy Club, which does a lot of like workshops, or they do campings for astro, like watching the stars or doing astrophotography.
All right, sir. I think that is it. We can end it here. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.